Hello and welcome to the non-Greg Sterlis, Greg Sterlis show, except only the substitutes. I'm your host, the Pemzon. I'm sorry, I'm covered in dust. I was sanding drywall.
Just now again.
Yeah.
Fun, you know. I don't know.
It's not very fun. It's much more fun to put the mud on than to sand it off. That is the truth.
It's all pretty lame, but I mean, I guess at least that part's kind of exciting.
The putting it on.
I guess. I don't know.
I'd rather put it on than sand it off. It's just very messy. I mean, I'm pretty messy when I put it on. I'm not going to lie. Some people put it on and, you know, they just look like a normal human afterwards. And me, I'm covered in mud.
I don't know how you couldn't be. I mean, really.
Some people are neat.
Okay, so
I remember showing, like, I worked at the YMCA and I taught little kids and, I'm like, let's do some origami, kids. You know, let's make this origami bird. And I'm like, okay, now you fold this and you do this and line it up here and fold it here and fold it here. And I'm like, and here's your bird. And I hold up my bird. It's all like, meh. And theirs are all perfect. And I was like, oh. Oh. I'm a messy person.
Well, that's all right. I mean, whatever.
It made the kids feel good. They were like super excited. Their birds look better than mine.
I used to love this cartoon called The Dirty Bird, and I remember interviewing the guy who made it, and it was just about, a bird, and this cat keeps trying to eat it, and it's just got these giant stupid eyes, and every time the cat tries to eat it, it just takes its butt out and starts dancing.
Wait, what?
I don't know. I just started thinking about the Dirty Bird cartoon, because they just released, like, a longer edit of it. But I love, it's just really stupid. It's just a bird, and it just starts dancing every time it takes its butt out.
Oh, okay.
I don't know. It's very amusing.
I'm also looking very messy and haggard because we're doing this last minute because there was a COVID outbreak.
We
had to all get tested.
Raging.
And make sure we didn't have it. And yeah, it's still, well, the new strain, the Delta variant, is super contagious. Like something like 10 people got it at this one event, which I guess is kind of low for considering some events. It was mostly people touching the same things, microphones, etc.
Every time people say that, I think of like Delta Blues, like Charlie Patton and stuff.
Yeah, so that's a bummer because super contagious, and the Delta variant affects children, which is terrible because children have not been vaccinated. So
yeah, it's not good.
All very bad, yes, and making me quite sad.
Yeah, that damn vid's still damn out vid. There screwing with people, but I don't know.
It absolutely
it's
is.
It's been a wild time.
It has been a wild time. Like, everybody's, like, getting tested. And I'm seeing everybody's stuff coming back. Yeah. Mostly it was the bands that played and the staff at the place and not really the people watching the bands, which is good, I guess. That it was contained. Not good for the people in the bands, though.
No, obviously not. But, yeah, I don't know. Just keep thinking about that bird's butt. It's so dumb. You ever see that one skit? I forget the name of the character where Sacha Baron Cohen convinces a bunch of people in Congress to say that we should arm kindergartners?
No.
Oh, that cracks me up.
No. I did not. I'm sure.
A bunch of four-year-olds with, like, guns. That
oh
cracks
boy.
Me up. They're, like, dead serious. Like, yeah.
I know four-year-olds, and you cannot give them guns.
No, you probably shouldn't do that.
You can't even really give them sticks or anything.
You can barely give them spoons.
Right, yeah.
I don't know. I just find that hilarious. But no, that damn vid's just out there. It's making its revenge strike, and it's, you know.
We had somebody who recognized our show, and we went out to eat at We Checks. Thanks for watching us. If you're watching tonight, thank you.
Yeah, every time I've had somebody know the show, it's always been around either there or in South Buffalo proper. A lot of people in Talties used to know what it was.
Oh, really? Cool. Yeah,
but
hello to you people of Talties as well.
Yeah, no. I don't know. I mean, I don't know. It's just that damn vid. No, I just keep thinking about that stupid Dirty Bird cartoon where it's like the...
I don't know what you're talking about.
Well, I don't think you would. I mean, okay. Unless you're like a real cartoon head like I am. I don't think too many people have seen Dirty Bird, but you can look it up for free. I love the Dirty Bird. It's from the 80s. Maybe the
Help
early
me, because I don't know what John is talking about.
No, nobody else is gonna. It's just, I don't know, it's just how to explain it. It's just this really wacky bird, and this cat keeps going up to sit next to it, and all of a sudden the bird's like... And it starts dancing, and it takes its butt out, and then the cat...
When you say takes its butt out,
it
I
like,
keep thinking
it, like,
it disconnects
takes
its
feathers
its
out.
Butt.
And then it's got like a bare bird butt.
Oh, okay. So it
and then
exposes
the cat,
a bare bird butt.
Yeah, but then but it just starts dancing for fun, and the cat gets annoyed, and he throws him off the tree, and the bird just keeps coming back and dancing. I don't. It's a lot more amusing than I'm making it seem.
Yeah,
but.
It just seems like kind of normal cat behavior. Like, get out of here. Speaking of which, did the cat come out of the wall yet? Oh, crap.
No, there he is. He just did right now.
He just did? Okay. He came out of another hole in the wall. Is that what he did? Oh, the same one. Okay. Very good. Very good, kitty. Very good. A while back, I was like I was falling asleep in my bed. This is a few years back. And I heard noises. What I thought were noises in the wall. But then I convinced myself that I was just imagining them. And they weren't real. And I was just dreaming them as I was falling asleep. Then all of a sudden I hear this crazy scream. And I can't see anything. And then something hits me in the chest. And my cats go flying, and they're screaming. The landlord's cat used to climb up through the wall to get into my apartment.
I don't even know how these
and he
cats
had jumped,
find these little areas.
Jumped into my bed. He was a black cat, and to attack my cats. But of course, when he jumped, he screamed, but I couldn't see him because he was a black cat. I was...
Ninja kitty.
That was very terrifying. I had a lot of trouble falling asleep.
Well, yeah. Who knows what's crawling around in the walls? You never know.
Well, Mosey just was. But yeah. Mosey isn't very...
No, he's not that adventurous. He probably just wanted to see a little bit.
He's a pretty chill guy, the Mosey.
But, yes, I don't know. But I don't know. We're not very exciting today because we're caught off guard.
We do have video, but we just don't have time to get together and show it. So we have more. Keep looking at. Oh, look at that.
I just keep thinking about more cartoons. Like, I was thinking a lot about the very first Yogi Bear, which is Pie Pirates.
Oh, I should have worked. That's.
If you want to hear like Boo Boo with a weirder voice, and there's no Ranger Smith, he's like more nasally, which I like later Boo Boo's voice, but I still like Pie Pirates Boo Boo. I don't know. I like those 50s Hanna-Barbera's. I know I always say this stuff, but Pie Pirates is just such a classic.
The Hanna-Barbera stuff?
The early stuff. Like, I just like the early, you know, 50s and 60s Hanna-Barbera. I mean, I say this every time. This is no... nobody else cares, but... Like, you know, Huckleberry Hound is great. You know, Boo Boo and Yogi are great. The Ranger Smith's hilarious. You know, Top Cat's one of the best ones. Oh, my God. Pixie and Dixie and Mr. Jinx. I cannot find those anywhere. Those are so good. It's just so funny. It's like, come on. It's just this cat. Goes,
not even on the YouTubes?
I can find like one clip
wow.
from like an ad, because it's like
are they copyright protected and they get taken down or something? What year are they from?
Like the early '60s, very late
and
'50s.
Hanna-Barbera, you said?
Yeah, but who's gonna like care about Pixie and Dixie and Mr. Jinx? Hanna-Barbera doesn't even exist anymore.
Well, shit. I got no explanation.
It's just super obscure and nobody cares other than me. But, you know, I just love Mr. Jinx. That voice forever in my childhood. There's one cartoon that they made in the 90s, like, because they started re-bringing back some of the 50s Hanna-Barbera in the 90s, like when they did I forget what they called them, but those are pretty good. That's like the only one that's on YouTube, which is fine, but I want to watch like real Mr. Jinx. Oh, and remember Terrytoons? They had Heckle and Jekyll, and then what was
I
the other?
I do remember Heckle and Jekyll, actually.
Those Terrytoons, they're like the C grade studio, but they're so good. Oh, and remember Mr. Gandhi and the cat Whiskers?
No.
Oh man,
I don't remember that.
There's so
I'm sorry.
Good. No, that's okay. I'm pretty sure nobody does. There's just so many good like obscure cartoon characters. Like the first TV cartoon was Crusader Rabbit, but and then Hashimoto Mouse was not long after, but those are barely cartoons. They're just like still images that people talk over from the 40s.
Yeah, that's well.
That's it makes Hanna-Barbera look like ultimate quality stuff, you know, but Mr. Jinx, it's that voice where he goes, I hate me so two pieces! That's just so funny.
I mean,
I could find other Hanna-Barbera stuff in the era, but I just think nobody cares about Mr. Jinx and Pixie and Dixie. They're just, come on, it's mice with bow ties and vests on.
Well, that's nice.
That's, come on. You'll never see them in a cartoon now.
They won't wear bow ties and vests?
I've never seen a cartoon where there's, like, just mice talking to a cat, and they're wearing, like, bow ties, and they're just, it's just, like, I don't know. Cartoons now, they gotta have all these stupid morals in them and stuff. Like, there's no moral in Mr. Jinx, like, getting hypnotized, and then the dog punches him. That's awesome.
What was the one you liked that's on Sunday morning?
Beanie and Cecil's great, too.
Beanie and Cecil,
That's really great. Man, those are... Yeah, those, the 80s Beanie and Cecil is really great, too. Like, of course, the 50s and 60s Beanie and Cecil are, like, amazing. But when they brought it back in the 80s, those are really good. Just kind of like the Mighty Mouse. Like, when they brought back Mighty Mouse in the 80s, those are really good.
I did not watch the Mighty Mouse.
That's okay. Mighty Mouse is... I think Mighty Mouse in the 80s is one of the few ones that's better a lot of times than the ones in the 50s. I mean, yeah, I don't know. Mighty Mouse is awesome. And I think Beanie and Cecil is even better. But, like, because, I mean, Ralph Bakshi is great, but, like, you can, like, he's just kind of crazy.
What about Animaniacs? Did you like them? A lot of people love them.
It's just, like, such a garbage ripoff of, like, it's just like if you take these people that draw these boring, lame 70s and 80s cartoons and, like, put a gun to their head and say, draw something good from the 40s, and they don't know what they're doing, so it just comes out like that.
How about Pinky and the Brain?
It's the same thing. All those ones.
The same thing.
It's all the same crap. Yeah, it is.
Yeah. Are they part of Animaniacs?
Yeah, they were part of it.
Oh, okay. I didn't realize.
I mean, Tiny Toons started out okay.
They kind of broke away, though, like, and became
Yeah, it became its own thing.
Yeah,
it's like, I don't know. You know, Tiny Toons started out okay, but... I just feel like that stuff, it's like by people who don't know why cartoons are funny and they're trying to make cartoons. So it's like, well, don't even make the cartoon. Let a real cartoonist make it.
That's fair.
I don't know. It's just like lame. It's like if you took somebody who's never made a pizza and you're like, you got to make this right now. And they're like, all right, they might try their best, but it's still probably not going to be that great.
Have they tasted a pizza?
I don't know. Maybe. They might have thought about it once or smelled one.
Have they seen a picture?
I don't know. There's so many, like, good cartoons.
Have they had spaghetti?
I mean, maybe.
Sauce.
They might have, like, tried it, but they didn't even like it, so
all
they,
right,
like...
All right, okay.
I don't know. The point is, Animaniacs is... It's just, like, so imitation cartoon. Like, I can watch it, I guess, but why would I watch that when I could watch a real cartoon? Like, Courage the Cowardly Dog, that's a real cartoon. Those are really good.
Do you ever go on thearchive.org? Because there's lots of obscure stuff on there.
I do. And there's also Watch Cartoon Online, which just has, like, the mega archive of cartoons. But, like, thearchive.org does have a lot of good stuff, but, like, Watch Cartoon Online is, like, specific to watch Like, it's just the archive of, like, every cartoon.
Well, there's weird, there's a section that's, like, vintage cartoons or some shit, but then there's a whole other section with way more cartoons that isn't really labeled that clearly. That's... So, I'm not sure that, you know, all of them are supposed to be there, but...
There's just so many good, like,
there's,
legendary...
like, these huge archives of, like, Russian cartoons, which are pretty interesting.
Yeah, that's true.
You're like, I'm unconvinced.
No, I don't know. I just like American cartoons. Like, you know, you got from the 80s era, there's just so much good stuff that was, like, repressed. Like, the legends of the 80s are, like, Lynn Naylor, Bob Camp, John Kay, Jim Smith, Lauren Faust, all these great names, but, like, they're just so repressed in the 80s. Because, like, you know, everything in the 80s was, like, all right, they came up with some, like, ugly toy. And then they just wanted to make you, like, have them make the cartoon just be, like, a giant, like, ad for this ugly toy. But, like, also had the cartoon be even uglier. And then you got the crap, like, Yo-Yogi and stuff. Like, why would you ever make that? Why would you ever do anything like...
You didn't bring up your albums that you got.
Oh, yeah. I got some great pre-Hanna-Barbera Smurf stuff.
At, we're not telling you where it is, but at our... The best Salvation Army. It's kind of far away. It's like almost 3 hours away. But it's great.
But it is a great
Woman's
one.
Woman's like, yeah, you know, other Salvation Armies, they like go through stuff and put it online, but we don't have time for that shit. And I was like, awesome. That's great.
The best part.
Because here I am just trying to buy shit. Use shit that someone gave you at a reasonable price instead of like, you know, shop Goodwill where like a bass clarinet, you have to pay, you know, almost as much as you would on eBay. There's no guarantee, or at least the sellers on eBay ostensibly give you some kind of guarantee. And you got to pay like $1 billion for shipping. And they got the fucking thing for free.
Yeah, that is the best Salvation Army.
It is. That one's great. They're like, we don't have time to sort through this and put it on eBay and send it to other people. So go ahead, what'd you get?
Oh, I got that great Smurfs record. It's really cool. I love pre-Hanna-Barbera Smurfs. You know, Smurfs came out in the late 40s by this guy named Peyo. His name was Pierre, but he lived in the Netherlands, so none of his family could say Pierre, and they called him Peyo, so that was his nickname. But
how'd he get named Pierre if no one could say his name?
Well, he was from France.
Oh, he was from France, okay.
But, you know, he lived in the Netherlands. But anyway, it's this weird guy who's like some kind of like left-wing like folk musician. But, like, he made a bunch of Smurfs albums. And, like, they're really obscure. And, like, the only way you could have got them in the 70s was to order them through some kind of Smurf Holland-based catalog.
It was Father Abraham's Smurf album.
Yeah, and he's got another one, too. I want to hear it. Like, he still doesn't. Like, even now, he's still really associated with the Smurfs in the Netherlands. Like, I thought this guy was ancient, but he really wasn't that old at the time. I mean, he's still pretty... He's, like, not super ancient now, but...
My favorite Netherlands cartoon is Dr. Snuggles, because it's really...
Those are fun.
Ridiculous, yeah. It's very psychedelic and strange.
But...
Bum-ba-bum-bum,
I mean, I'm not a big anime guy, but I do love One Piece. This is hilarious, because let's face it, this guy's a master of color, and the whole time he was trying to base it on, like, well, what if Tom and Jerry was even more ridiculous and had superpowers? And that's just so funny, like...
Which Tom and Jerry...
Well, probably the original Hanna-Barbera from the 30s.
Well, there was a Tom and Jerry that was earlier that was two dudes.
Well, that wasn't that related to the cartoon, though.
No, there was a cartoon one.
Well, okay. Well, all I know is that the original Tom and Jerry cat and mouse team were made by Hanna-Barbera in the 30s, based off the phrase Tom and Jerry.
Okay.
Which may have been applied to other people or other cartoons even. But I think, actually, technically, the first Tom and Jerry cartoon was in 1940. But, yeah, they were originally made by Hanna-Barbera for MGM. Are you sure you're not talking about Mutt and Jeff?
No, I don't think so. I'm going to look it up.
I mean, yeah, Tom and Jerry cartoons.
Maybe.
Like, there was the phrase Tom and Jerry that just referred to, like, a certain kind of people.
What did it refer to?
I forget, but I know that's where they got the name for the cartoons. Now, I don't even really like Tom and Jerry.
I really am a terrible speller. Sometimes it's tough.
It's like the most generic cartoon ever. But it's like, it's enjoyable to look at, like, for just like the spectacle of a cartoon. But they're not like that good. They're all right. It's like Archie. Well, I think Archie's way better than Tom and Jerry. But, yeah, I don't
know.
Tom and Jerry got taken over by...
The problem is that, of course, the regular Tom and Jerry are going to show
up. Let's look it up on Wikipedia. I'll probably tell you.
Okay.
But I'm pretty sure, I mean, I don't know tons about the history of Tom and Jerry. Just a very basic outline. Like, it got taken over by Chuck Jones for a while, which he's, like, everybody's favorite Hanna-Barbera guy. He's all right. I think he got lame towards the end. Like, I think Chuck Jones needed, like, other people to, like, make him interesting. But, yeah, I don't know. When Chuck Jones
took... So this not guaranteed to function, it looks like it could have a repair on it. Bass clarinet, that's a Normandy. It's not wood. You're going to probably have to put at least... If you got a repair person to redo it for $350, that's cheap. I mean, I don't know. Ridiculous. Goodwill.com, you're ridiculous.
Which reminds me, I keep seeing this thing really old people share on Facebook about supposedly the creator of Tom and Jerry and how he died like last year. But the thing is, he would have been like 8 when Tom and Jerry even came out in 1940, and he didn't start working on any Tom and Jerry's until like the late 50s.
There, see? Right there.
Okay, that's probably not related to the regular Tom and Jerry cat, though.
There. Before the Cat and the Mouse.
All right.
Van Buren's Tom and Jerry.
That's fair. It's something that came up before, but it's not related, I'm assuming.
Yeah, it's not related, but I was just saying.
No, those I actually never heard of. I'm surprised.
Well, I know because my students used it in some of their stuff.
Wow, I'm actually surprised by that. It's probably better than actual Tom and Jerry. Tom and Jerry's okay. Like, I can watch. It's just, like, boring. Like, it's, like, the most generic cartoon. Like, those look, like, more fun than... I don't know, whatever. Yeah, that's cool. I had no idea. Because even that is fascinating. Tom and Jerry, the phrase, existed previously. It's a 19th century phrase. And I'm sure you can look it up what it means, but I don't remember. But the first, like, big famous icon character was Felix... Because some woman in the entertainment industry, even though Felix cartoons were being made, she was the first one to like mass produce Felix toys in the 20s, and that's why Felix became like this huge icon. But I like Felix. I like Felix way better than Tom and Jerry. See, this already looks better than regular Tom and Jerry.
You have to hit Van Buren's Tom and Jerry.
This must have been like 10 years before. That's crazy.
It's really. I mean, I think, I don't know, I'd have to read more about it. I just know my students use it in some of their...
See, yeah, that's fascinating. I love cartoons, and
see,
I know all about cartoons.
It's very much like the Fleischer Studios where everything's alive and...
But 10 steps down.
Fleischer?
This is way not as good as those.
Well...
It's alright. You guys can't see it, but I'm telling you, it's alright. It's fun. But come on. If this was some actual Fleischer, it'd be way cooler looking.
I need to look this up and...
Yeah.
Anyway. Well, I'm not really... When did Fleischer start doing their Betty Boops and stuff? This might be
Betty
older.
Boop was 19... No, Fleischer's really old. Like, they did it before sound, though.
Okay. These guys might have, too, though.
But, because the first Fleischer cartoons were Coco the Clown.
But those weren't, like... Those were just demonstrations they did, right?
Well, they evolved into actual cartoons, though.
Mm-hmm.
And a Betty Boop was from a 1925, I think, called Dirty Ditches, or no, Ditzy Dishes. And in the original Betty Boop, she's actually not human, she's a dog. And that's why
See, look, there's a bad note on the piano, so they kicked it out, and now they're chasing it.
Yeah, it's fun. I'd rather.
Now, oh, the poor note is crying. Oh, shoot.
Yeah, but,
Let me... Hold on here. There we go.
Oh, man. Oh, there you go. Yeah, see, this cartoon's pretty good. It's better than regular Tom and Jerry, which are okay, but... Yeah, this looks pretty cool. This is high quality TV. Watching
there were
TV of a.
I think that they were definitely very early though, because I remember.
No, I'm sure. I just Fleischer is like.
The best of the best?
No, I just think they... I'd be surprised if this was earlier than that just because they had all those silent cartoons.
Well, they did do a lot of innovation.
And, yeah, I don't know. I know. You know, they did have Betty Boop when she originally was a dog in Ditsy Dishes. I forget what year. I know it was in the 20s. You know, Popeye was later. I think Popeye was 1933, even though Popeye in the comics was a while before that. And, of course, Popeye in the comics...
Who's Joseph Barbera? Is that one of the Hanna-Barbera people?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that was his first stuff he did.
Oh, so he actually did work on it.
Yeah.
So they just took the names and applied it to the cat and dog later? Or
I
the cat and mouse? Wow.
I guess so. Well, that was a lot more interesting than Tom and Jerry.
Yeah, Tom and Jerry sucks later. It's like, it's all right. It's just so boring. Yeah, Joseph Barbera. Yeah, that's the guy who made Hanna-Barbera.
He was an animator and storyman, so he wasn't totally responsible for it.
Okay, so it was kind of related. I mean, obviously it's not related as in, like, the same characters.
And then
then
they did Tom and Jerry afterwards.
See, that's fascinating, because I, you know, I love cartoons. I didn't really know that.
Then they changed their names to Dick and Larry instead of Tom and Jerry.
Oh, they still existed with actual Tom and Jerry cartoons?
I guess so.
It's crazy, because Tom and Jerry existed, it started in 1940. But... That's really weird. I don't know. I don't know as much about actual Tom and Jerry.
Ah, Fleischer staff sometimes worked with them. So there you go. That's why it has some of the similarities.
You know, it's... I don't know. I just love cartoons. I don't know as much about those guys. But I should because it looks kind of fun. But I don't know. I do, not so many super modern cartoons I like. I did like the Venture Brothers. That was great. I, of course, do love Courage. Although, the voice of Muriel just died. That was very sad. I was thinking about Courage the Cowardly Dog, and the voice of Muriel Bag just died, which is very sad. She was always like, oh, Courage, let's go make some baklava. And you're like, oh, boy. It's all about this old Scottish woman, and she tries to make baklava, but it always turns into bubblegum.
Oh, what?
It's really strange.
That's very strange.
She's like, oh, Courage, let's go make some more baklava.
True story, I really screwed up my tooth with baklava. I was eating it, and I had I had 3 wisdom tooth, not a fourth, only 3. I had an odd number. And one had came in, and it was just down in the back of my mouth, minding its own business. And I'm eating the baklava, and there is a shell in it, and it goes right into that wisdom tooth and cracks it in two. It's stuck in the wisdom tooth.
Ugh.
Yeah, it wasn't so great. I had to have it pulled out.
Oh, my God. I have a lot of wisdom teeth. I have, like, 8. But
what? How do you have 8?
Because I have two on each side, on top and bottom.
Wow. That's crazy. I never heard of that.
To have such perfect straight teeth. And then they got totally, totally screwed up.
Now still have the wisdom teeth?
Yeah, I never got them taken out. But yeah, I used to have really, really straight teeth. And
I still
totally
have my top ones.
Up.
They're
called that because they didn't used to get come out until you were like in your 60s or 70s back in the day. But they
oh,
come
really?
Out, yeah, that's what I heard at least. But they come out faster now because people eat more sugar.
I mean, I remember, you know, dentists would be like, gotta have those out. They're gonna rot. I'm like, why are they gonna rot? Like, why are they gonna rot any more than the rest of my teeth? They came in. There's room for them. They're in my mouth. In fact, there's extra room since I have a gap in my front 2 teeth. And then, you know, I was feeling kind of like, maybe I'm being irresponsible. And I went to this old school dentist that was on the corner of, let's see, where was he? He was above the Thai place across from Milky's. That's where I used to be. And I went up there, and it was this old guy. And I'm like, you know, I guess I should have my wisdom tooth out. And he's like, do they hurt? I'm like, no. He's like, then why pull them out? I was like, oh, okay, that's what I thought.
Yeah, I mean, that's what makes sense.
So I think lots of times, you know,
oh,
people are just like, ooh, those are lots of money in my
yeah,
pocket.
I'm sure it is.
And surely they do cause trouble for people, but
I
not,
read somewhere
not
that it's like
all the time.
80% of people by the time they're 60, they do rot, but I'm sure.
Oh, really?
But I'm sure as long as you like watch it out, they probably won't.
I mean, yeah, and if you have room in your mouth hole for them.
Anyway.
Yes, give us a call. Give us a call. Let us know. My dad had his whole life. He never had them taken out.